Good morning students, myself Dr. Gibran Amar presents to Simply Pathology, and today we are starting with the second part of viral hepatitis. So in the previous lecture I had discussed about the hepatitis A, hepatitis B and hepatitis C in details. Today we are going to discuss the remaining hepatitis and also the clinicopathological syndromes along with the morphological patterns of acute and chronic hepatitis, as well as certain special morphological descriptions of chronic hepatitis B and chronic hepatitis C. So first we are going to see hepatitis D. So if you know that the hepatitis D virus, okay, it is also called as the Delta agent, is a unique form of a single-stranded RNA virus that is dependent for its life cycle on hepatitis B virus. It is a single-stranded RNA virus. Remember that around 5% of the HBV infected individuals are co-infected with hepatitis D virus. Now the route of transmission, if you see, is parenteral, okay, IV drug use or by blood transfusion. Now remember one thing, it is a 35 nanometer double shelled particle which is having an outer coat antigen and an inner antigen. Now the inner antigen is called as the Delta antigen, and it is the only protein which is produced by the virus called as the HD antigen. Okay. Now the double shelled particle is also associated with a single stranded RNA. Now remember the hepatic injury is via both the viral cytopathic effect as well as cytotoxic host response. Okay. Now the infection is occurring in two settings. Either they can be a co-infection which is characterized by a simultaneous infection with hepatitis B virus and the HDV. Hepatitis D virus that can lead to acute hepatitis, or there can be a super infection, okay, that can result a chronic hepatitis B carrier being infected by a hepatitis D virus. Okay, that is what is a super infection is. So if you look, the co-infection is basically self-limited, but there is a high rate of acute hepatic failure in IV drug users, whereas the super infection is taking place in two scenarios. Okay. So there can be a severe acute hepatitis in an asymptomatic hepatitis B carrier, or there can be exacerbation of pre-existing chronic hepatitis B infection. So there can be two scenarios in case of a super infection. Okay. Now remember that the chronic hepatitis D virus, it occurs in 80% of super infection and has two phases. So basically chronicity with hepatitis D virus will only take place in case of a super infection. That is a new hepatitis D virus which is happening in a case of a chronic hepatitis B carrier. Okay. And that will result in a chronic hepatitis. Okay. Now it can have a two phases. Okay. There can be an acute phase with rapid and active hepatitis D virus replication, with decreased hepatitis B virus replication and increased transaminases, and there can be a chronic phase, okay, with a decreased hepatitis D virus replication and an increased hepatitis B virus replication, and they will have variable amount of transaminases. Okay. Now acute HDV infection, remember in that what parameters can we use for serology? One is you can see the HDV RNA, there will be replication, so that is present in the blood just before and in the early days of the acute hepatitis. And the second parameter is, which is a more reliable marker for acute HDV infection, that is IgM anti-HDV antibody. Again, in case of a chronic hepatitis D virus infection, okay, from super infection, okay, so in this case the HBsAg antigen will be positive along with anti-HDV antibody, that will be positive. Okay. One thing remember, that co-infection of HDV and HBV increases the risk of cirrhosis as well as hepatocellular carcinoma. Now we are going to read about hepatitis E. Now the hepatitis E virus is basically a single stranded unenveloped positive stranded RNA virus which is belonging to the hepivirus genus. Okay. Now the virus itself, again, it is not cytopathic. Okay, therefore the hepatic injury is due to the host immune system response. It is just like hepatitis A virus. This is also enterically transmitted via fecal oral transmission, and it is primarily taking place in young to middle aged adults. Now hepatitis E virus is basically a zoonotic disease, and it is having animal reservoirs. Now, hepatitis E virus infection is accounting for more than 30% of the cases of sporadic acute hepatitis in India. And this frequency is much more than hepatitis A virus. Now, the incubation period, if you see, for hepatitis E virus is around 4 to 5 weeks. And it is a self-limited acute hepatitis with a resolution occurring in 2 to 4 weeks. Now, chronic hepatitis E virus infection, okay? Remember, in immunocompetent individuals, it is not seen. Whereas in case of immunocompromised individuals, for example, transplant recipients or patient on immunosuppression or AIDS patient, okay, you will have a chronic HEV infection in immunocompromised patient. Now, acute hepatitis E virus is associated with an increased mortality approximately to the tune of 20% in pregnant women. Now, if you look at the serology, in the acute phases, you will have IgM anti-HEV antibody, whereas when the patient is recovering, they will have IgG anti-HEV antibody. Now, before the onset of symptoms, if you see, the HEV RNA is detected by PCR in stool as well as in serum. Now, what are the most commons in viral hepatitis? Let us see. Now, the most common acute viral hepatitis in India or world is hepatitis A. Again, the most common acute viral hepatitis in children is hepatitis A. But when the most common acute viral hepatitis in adults, okay, whether it be epidemic or sporadic, okay, in India or in world, it is hepatitis E. Most common cause of chronic viral hepatitis, the answer will be hepatitis C. Most common viral hepatitis causing hepatocellular carcinoma, or most common cause of carrier, or most common viral hepatitis associated with transfusion, the answer will be hepatitis B. Most common hepatitis, viral hepatitis causing cirrhosis, the answer is hepatitis C. Now, with regard to hepatitis D, the most common cause for fulminant hepatitis is hepatitis D. Now, fulminant hepatitis usually occurs because of co-infection of hepatitis B and hepatitis D, and chronicity occurs because of superinfection of hepatitis B and hepatitis D, as already discussed. So, now, hepatitis A virus and hepatitis E virus, okay, in immunocompetent individuals do not cause chronic hepatitis, just to remind you. The very small number of hepatitis B positive patients will proceed towards chronic hepatitis. And large number of patients, okay, who are infected with hepatitis C will progress to chronic hepatitis. Remember, acute liver failure is unusual and is seen primarily with hepatitis A virus, B virus, and D virus infection. Hepatitis E virus can also cause acute liver failure in pregnant women. Okay, so now we are going to see the summary of viral hepatitis. Now, for your exam purpose, okay, when you have exams for writing your answers, when you do not have a lot of time, in that case, this particular chart is going to help you a lot, okay, to summarize everything. So just to repeat, okay, hepatitis A, the type of virus, it is a single-stranded, non-enveloped picornavirus belonging to hepatovirus family, and it is non-cytopathic. If you look at the route of transmission of hepatitis A, it is the fecal-oral route via the contaminated food or water, the mean incubation period being 2 to 6 weeks, and the frequency of chronic liver disease, that it never develops chronic disease, and the diagnosis is the serum IgM antibodies. Okay, now for Hep B, it is hepatitis B is a double-stranded DNA virus, envelope virus belonging to hepatitis family, and it is non-cytopathic. The route of transmission being parenteral, sexual contact, perinatal. The mean incubation period is 2 to 26 weeks. The frequency of chronic liver disease is around 5 to 10%, and the diagnosis is via HBsAg antigen or HBc antigen antibodies, okay, that is the IgM variety if you remember, and the PCR for HBV DNA. Okay, so remember, only 5 to 10% cases of hepatitis B will develop chronic liver disease. Now, if you look at the hepatitis C, it is a single-stranded RNA virus which is enveloped belonging to flavivirid family, and it is directly cytopathic to the hepatocytes. The route of transmission being parenteral, again a very high chance of transmission via the intranasal cocaine use. The mean incubation period is around 4 to 26 weeks, and the risk of developing chronic hepatitis is 80% for Hep C. Now, we do ELISA for HCV antibodies, okay, most commonly the anti-HCV antibodies that we do, and we can do the PCR for HCV RNA. Now, hepatitis D, if you see, it is a circular defective single-stranded RNA. Again, it is a cytopathic in nature, and the route of transmission is parenteral and incubation period is same as HBV. Now, one very important MCQ over here is that 10% of the hepatitis D cases, okay, they present as a co-infection, whereas 90 to 100% will have super infection leading to chronic hepatitis. Now, the diagnosis is via the serum IgM antibodies as well as the IgG antibodies and PCR for HDV RNA. Now, hepatitis E, if you see, is a single-stranded RNA hepivirus belonging to hepivirus family, non-cytopathic, the route of transmission being fecal-oral. The mean incubation period is around 4 to 5 weeks, and it does not develop chronic hepatitis in immunocompetent individuals. Only in case of immunocompromised individuals that they are going to develop chronic liver disease. And basic diagnosis is with the help of serum IgM and IgG antibodies and PCR for HEV RNA. Okay, so this is just to summarize the different hepatitis viruses. Now we are going to read about the clinicopathological syndrome in viral hepatitis. So if you see, number one, we are having an acute asymptomatic infection with recovery. So here the infection is identified due to minimally elevated transaminases. After recovery, it is identified by the presence of antiviral antibodies, as we already know. And such kind of asymptomatic infection is quite common with hepatitis A and hepatitis B virus. They can present with a subclinical infection, which can be confirmed with the help of anti-HBV or anti-HBV antibodies. Okay. The second clinical spectrum is acute liver failure. Now around 10% cases of acute hepatic failure is due to viral hepatitis. Now over here, remember, the most common cause of acute liver failure worldwide is hepatitis A and E, whereas that in Asia is hepatitis B. If the disease does not resolve spontaneously, okay, in that case, you might require liver transplant. Now, chronic hepatitis is, it is basically any symptomatic biochemical or serological evidence of condition of continuing or relapsing hepatic disease for more than 6 months. Okay, so basically most commonly it is seen with hepatitis B, C and hepatitis E in case of immunocompromised individuals. Now, the morphology of viral hepatitis. Okay, just before the morphology, the carrier state we have already discussed when I have read about the hepatitis B. Remember, the term healthy carrier is only used for hepatitis B and not for hep C. Okay, now morphology, if we see, so the morphological features of acute and chronic hepatitis is quite similar and overlapping with the autoimmune hepatitis, adverse drug reactions and Wilson's disease. So these are basically the differential diagnosis for your viral hepatitis. So acute viral hepatitis. Now we are going to read about the morphology of acute viral hepatitis. So if you look over here, there is a portal tract composed of the branch of portal artery, bile ductule and the portal vein. There is a scant mononuclear cell. Okay, we can see the normal hepatocytes. Again, apoptosis, as we can see. Okay, what we can also see some mild cholestasis, the central vein. Again, the ballooning degeneration of the hepatocytes that we can see. And the macrophage aggregates also we can see over here, which is basically clearing the debris. Okay. So let us see. So grossly, in case of acute hepatitis, the liver might be normal in size. It might be enlarged in case of inflammation. It can be shrunken. So it can be shrunken in case of acute liver failure with massive necrosis. Okay. So microscopic examination is characterized by classical portal and lobular inflammation composed predominantly of lymphocytes. Yes, it is an acute hepatitis, yet the predominant cell is lymphocytes and variable amounts of plasma cells and eosinophils you are going to see. It is characterized by necrosis and apoptosis. So hepatocyte death is taking place by both necrosis and apoptosis. So the pattern of necrosis can be confluent, that is, there is a necrosis of group of hepatocyte, or it can be pan lobular or pan acinar, that is necrosis of an entire lobule of hepatocyte. Now this occurs only in severe cases. Also, you are going to find macrophages which are scavenging or clearing the cell debris. So this is all about the acute hepatitis. Now, the morphology of chronic viral hepatitis, if you see, okay, it is characterized by, so here is the portal tract. Now, if you see, the portal tract is quite expanded and is having dense mononuclear infiltrate, okay, and here is the central vein. There is a bridging fibrosis, and along with that, you can also see bridging necrosis over here, Okay. Now you have a characteristic ground glass cell. Okay, the hepatitis B. You are having a classical ground glass appearance inside the cell. What is the ground glass appearance? We are going to discuss later on. That is a classical morphological feature for chronic hepatitis. Whereas the fatty change along with lymphoid aggregates is a classical feature for hepatitis C. Again, you can also see ductular reactions. Okay, and then you can see the portal fibrosis. So fibrosis can be seen around the portal tracts. Then there is interface hepatitis, that is inflammation extending to the hepatocytes just around the portal tracts. Apoptosis, again you can see macrophage aggregates also, okay, which are clearing the debris. So the microscopic examination reveals portal. Predominantly it is characterized by portal lymphocytic or lymphoplasmacytic inflammation with fibrosis. This is the most classical feature of chronic hepatitis. Along with that, there is interface hepatitis. There is inflammation involving the periportal hepatocytes, variable amount of lobular inflammation with portal or periportal fibrosis, leading to bridging fibrosis and ultimately can lead to cirrhosis and death of the patient. Okay. So there are few distinct morphological features of chronic hepatitis. In case of a chronic hepatitis B virus, they can be swollen endoplasmic reticulum of hepatocytes which are filled with HBsAg antigen, giving a ground glass appearance. So IHC, if you do, you will find the staining for HBsAg antigen or HBC antigen. Now if you look at the hepatitis C, in chronic hepatitis C there is a prominent lymphoid aggregates or fully formed lymphoid follicles within the portal tracts. They will be fatty change or steatosis with genotype 3 variety, and there is bile duct injury with ductular reactions. Okay, now very important thing that I want to highlight once again, that lymphocyte, that is the T cells, they are the predominant cell type in both acute and chronic viral hepatitis. And remember, biopsy of the liver is carried out for the assessment of fibrosis for the staging purpose and to decide on the therapeutic approach for the patient. So with this, we have completed the entire portion of viral hepatitis. Hope you have understood and enjoyed this lecture. And in case of any doubts, you may comment in the comment section. And if you like the lecture, please do subscribe to my channel and please do share with those in need. Thank you very much, student.